teacher, trainer, and academic manager. He's Studycat's head of partnerships for Europe and has a master's in TESOL and is also a Trinity CertTESOL moderator and a DipTESOL examiner. During Dave's session, we recommend watching him speak of you. And if you have any questions for Dave, please type them in the chat box. No, the Q&A box. Without any further ado, please share your screen, Dave.
Hello, everybody. It's great to see you there. Let me just share my screen and let's go. 1 second. Nearly there. Well, it's great to see everybody here to start with. So I'm really happy to have everybody here. Thank you for coming. Just so I know that everyone can hear me, could you just type in yes or why into the chat box? That'd be really helpful. Okay, excellent. Great. Oh, it looks like there everyone can hear me okay. That's fantastic. So as David said, I've been an educator since 2003, and I've always been fascinated with how we learn, and specifically how we can better help young learners acquire language. And over time, I've always come back to one thing. One of the best ways for young learners to learn is through play. And so that's the topic of my talk today. Let's jump straight in. So learning through play, it is, how can I say this? We'll be having a look at four things today. First of all, what learning through play actually is and the principles behind it. We'll then look at some of the rich history that has led us to where we are today, looking at the forerunners of learning through play. Now, that will lead us up to what we know about learning today. We'll have a very brief look at the latest science of learning. We'll then walk through examples of learning gameplay through an educational or edtech lens and see if modern gameplay on things like apps conforms to scientific principles of learning. And of course, in the last 5 minutes, there'll be time for Q&A. So if you have any questions as we go along, please do just type them into the Q&A box at the very bottom of your screen, and I'll be able to answer them at the end. Now, jumping in, over the years, educators, scientists, philosophers have gone back and forth on defining what learning through play is, if it's a valid concept, how useful it is, and most importantly, how to define the mechanisms behind how it works. There have been endless studies done on learning through play, but some of the current thought leaders, like Kathy Hirsch-Pasek, have put in thousands of hours of experimentation and thought and testing into distilling the science behind learning to play, learning through play, into some core principles. There are seven core principles. The first one, of course, is it has to be enjoyable. It has to be fun. If it's not fun, then we can hardly call it play. The second is that there shouldn't be any learning goals imposed by teachers or parents. It should be fun for fun's sake. The third is it should be spontaneous. So I, for example, if I put my six-year-old daughter in a room with another six-year-old, inevitably they're going to start playing together. And this is absolutely fascinating to watch when it starts to happen. Now, while they're playing, the fourth point and the fourth key principle is that there has to be active engagement and focused attention. It should also include elements of make-believe and imagination as well. And lastly, it's good if it can be iterative. And what we mean by that is that children take away something over time and can apply it to the next time they play. Now, that's a lot of information to give you very quickly, but we'll go through a little bit more slowly later. But the key point to mention is that not all of these should be or need to be present in every playful interaction, but the more of them that are, the more that play and learning will occur together. So you might be wondering, how on earth did we get to these seven principles? How were they discovered? What process did we get through to get here? Well, you might be surprised to learn that learning through play has had strong advocates in the educational and scientific community going back well over 100 years. So I thought it might be interesting to take a whirlwind tour of our predecessors, their ideas, so you can put or place play in its historical context. Let's jump through now. First up, one of the earliest proponents of play was Friedrich Froebel, who recognized that children have unique needs and capabilities. In the early 1800s, he created the concept and the term kindergarten as a place for children to play, learn and play at a very young age. And of course, I'm sure you've all heard of kindergartens today. He also emphasized things like hands-on materials, learning through experience, and child-centered learning, as did Maria Montessori. She created the educational practice that shares her name. And I'm sure you've heard of her method, which is still in use in schools across the world. The Montessori method emphasizes independence and, most importantly, an environment that's been prepared for them to learn. It assumes, of course, that children are naturally eager to learn, that they have intrinsic motivation, and also, as with Friedrich Froebel, that the use of hands-on materials, experiential learning, and child-centered learning as well. Around the same time that Marie Montessori was practicing her method, Lev Vygotsky was also active in putting forward some educational ideas, probably most well known for his concept called the zone of proximal development. Or it sounds like a mouthful, but what that really is what a child can do on their own versus what they can do with support or the help of a more knowledgeable other, which usually is a person, a teacher or a parent, but could also be a book or even an app as well. Around the same time in America, we had John Dewey, who was very active in the early 1900s. He was a philosopher and an educational reformer who was a passionate believer in democracy, and he weaved this idea through his educational thought, especially that education is social and interactive. You can see concepts starting to come out here like make-believe play, using imagination, as well as the experiential learning that others were thinking about at the same time too. And the last forerunner of learning through play, which I thought would be interesting to look at, was a gentleman called Chen Hexin, who was an educator, a child psychologist, and also a student of John Dewey's. He became known as the father of early childhood education in China, because he was especially focused on family as the primary learning unit. Looking at the family as a support platform to enable children to learn better. So putting all of that together, that brings us to today. All of these past achievements, these past passionate advocates in helping children learn in the most natural way, have led us to today's science, where we look at things from a more of a neuroscientific and cognitive science viewpoint. And over recent years, these areas have been exploding with the results, neuroimaging of the brain. And the wonderful thing from my point of view is that this science has validated so many of these early trailblazers' ideas, and so many of them have been confirmed by modern science. So moving on to look at what we know, the latest science of learning that we currently know, and how does it confirm what we know about learning through play? Well, when we talk about knowing how learning happens, what we're doing today is we're looking from this neuroscientific viewpoint, looking at what happens in the brain rather than a socio-emotional learning lens. So when we condense all of the science, it comes into four key points or four pillars of learning. And you'll notice that these are very similar or can encompass the ideas that we've looked at into learning through play. So let's go through these very quickly one by one. First of all, we look at attention. I think probably we all know what and understand what attention is, but from the brain's point of view, attention can be described as a filter that selects information to process while ignoring other data. And this actually allows processing to happen and ensures that the brain doesn't get overwhelmed or have too much cognitive load. For example, just imagine that your brain gave equal attention to every piece of input that you had, all the sounds, sights, and smells. Your brain would be quickly overwhelmed and you wouldn't be able to pay attention or focus on anything. Next up is the idea of active engagement. And this is the idea that to learn, you must be active. A passive organism simply doesn't learn. The interesting part about this one is that it's almost impossible to force a child to be engaged. All engagement is actually self-engagement. So I think usually as teachers and as parents, it's our job to appeal to the learner's interests, right? What personalized information, appeal to what you know interests them so they can naturally be engaged in the topics. This goes together with testing to ensure that the knowledge they learn is reliable. And one final point about active engagement is that making the task more difficult actually increases engagement up to a certain point, almost like the idea of the zone of proximal development by, or even Krashen and Terrell's I+1. As you increase engagement or increase the difficulty, so engagement also goes up to a point where it becomes too difficult and then the child or the student gives up. And finally, there's feedback, which is very simple, really. The brain is a learning and prediction machine. It predicts, it gets it right or wrong, gets that feedback, makes corrections, and then makes a new prediction. So of course, if you remove feedback from that cycle, the brain simply can't learn. It doesn't know what it got right, it doesn't know what it got wrong, and learning can't progress. In other words, without errors, we can't learn. But as Maria Montessori said, errors need to happen in a safe learning environment. Otherwise, students are afraid to make predictions and mistakes and when they could be punished for this, and they become very reluctant to take any risks whatsoever. And finally, we have consolidation. And this is the stage where learning moves from slow completion with errors to smooth and error-free performance over time. The key here is to repeat until performance can become automatic. And as we know, sleep is essential, so the brain can digest, heal, recover all of the information it's learned. So with all of that information, how does EdTech fit into this? As Jake Whidden mentioned in his plenary yesterday, do games and apps meet the requirements for learning or not? So what I'd like to do is take a little deep dive into three examples and look at one example each, one for attention, one for active engagement, and one for feedback. Now, for each game, I've selected a game from the Studycat for Schools app, which is designed for young learners. It starts at pre-A1 level, or when a child meets English for the first time. So let's jump in. Looking at attention first, what I'll do is I'll play the short clip. Please watch, and then we'll describe what could be happening from a learning perspective.
Says quack, 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 quack. Ducks are red, white or black. A horse says neigh, 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 neigh. Horses are brown or grey.
Okay, so it's colourful, it has catchy music, and it grabs attention. If you gave this to a young learner, or if I gave this to my daughter, I know that anything else in the environment would immediately be filtered out, allowing the brain to process just what it sees on the screen. Now, this is great for learning and it ticks that box. You've captured that attention, which is what's needed to happen before any processing or learning can take place. Also, I like to think I'm quite an experienced teacher, but even I would admit that an app like this is as good or better than myself at focusing and maintaining attention over a short period of time. At least I know what happens when I try to take the iPad away from my daughter. It also has actions to perform, such as tapping the animals as they appear. And there's lots of repetition too, to help with language input and processing. So this one gets a great tick for all the learning that's going on there as well. Next up, we have active engagement. And again, let's take a look at the video and then we'll talk about the learning principles behind it.
Hit the apple.
Hit the banana.
Hit the orange.
Hit the banana.
Hit the apple.
Pear.
Okay, it's a really simple game, and I'm sure you've all seen something similar, but it actually encompasses some quite complex learning ideas. And the ones here that are particular we'll look at are scaffolding and slowly increasing the cognitive load. Again, from Vygotsky's point of view, it gains attention, there's repetition, and slowly the level of difficulty is increased as the number of variables are increased. So as the number of fruits goes up, so the learner feels stretched to think and react in time. And this forces active engagement with the process, which again, ticks the box of meeting these learning principles. Let's go for the last one, activity, which is feedback. So let's watch again, but this time, a little test for you. I'd like you to watch and see if you can spot where the learner would get feedback and how it's delivered.
A dog.
Two rabbits.
A mouse. A dog.
Okay, so this one has all the features of learning from the previous games, and you'll notice that hopefully you spotted it, but when there's an error, there's immediate feedback. The dog goes from smiling and a happy face to a neutral face. A noise plays to let the child know, and points are shown as being lost. And what's happened here from a learning point of view is the child has made a prediction about what the word they hear means. They test it out by tapping and they receive immediate feedback that isn't correct. So, but again, this is a safe environment to make mistakes in. There are no dire circumstances or consequences, and practice continues. So with these three, I would suggest that it appears there are some things that EdTech can actually do better than us humans. Firstly, it allows more input, more repetition, and more feedback in a shorter period of time. Also, behind this StudyCat for Schools app is a learning algorithm that is called distributed practice, or even spaced repetition at times, that follows Ebbinghaus's forgetting curve, which is very complicated, but simply it means that if a learner makes a mistake with a particular word, they'll then see that word more often than words they got correct. And finally, and this is from a teaching point of view, one of the most fascinating points, is that an app like this can track and present us with learning data to enable us to make better learning decisions. Of course, I'm not suggesting that it can replace teachers in any way, but it can definitely enable us to do our jobs, or give us more information to do our jobs even better. So as an example with that, for the StudyCat for Schools app, here's some learning data you can see that's been collected by the app as the student plays these games. This is the teacher's dashboard in the back end, which you can log into from a browser, and you can see individual student data. So you can actually drop down and see what an individual learner got right, got wrong, where they're struggling. And also you can see a class in aggregate, how they're doing. So this can lead to informed decisions, such as things like grouping or differentiation in the class. If student A, B, and C got certain words incorrect, then in your next lesson, you can make the decision ahead of time. I'm going to put these students together in a group and provide them, which will differentiate them and give them some supportive material, scaffolding them, as Vygotsky would say. So again, it doesn't replace teachers. We still need that social interaction and co-constructed meaning to acquire a language, but it does allow students to practice extensively and effectively outside of the classroom. We talked about Chen He Qin's ideas of family being the key to learning. Well, our motto at StudyCat is to connect students, parents, and homes. As Chen He Qin proposed, learning does involve the whole family, and we're passionate about connecting them to improve learning outcomes. What that means in a practical sense is that parents are also able to see the same learning data for their child that the teacher can. as teachers have a teacher's dashboard, so parents can see their parent dashboard. And what we found from working with hundreds of schools is, and hundreds of parents and students, this starts the conversation between parents and teacher, or school and teacher and parent, and it builds trust over time. Teachers and parents can work in partnership to support learners both in the classroom and at home. So what that does, from a student's point of view though, they don't really notice anything different. They just notice that they have an almost endless set of fun games to play and engage with that are challenging, they're rewarded and encouraged to improve their scores. It's an environment, as Maria Montessori would approve of, that they could safely learn, make mistakes and errors almost consequence-free. Of course, we're making sure that we're also aligned to international standards. If you've heard of the Cambridge Assessment or the Cambridge Starters Programme, we're 96% aligned to the standards within that test. And if you're interested in exploring further, Studycat for Schools does have a complete learning package. We have the interactive whiteboard app. Essentially, it's the same app, but that runs on a smart board, an interactive whiteboard, smart projector, or even a desktop or laptop if you have to teach online, if we're in lockdown again. It also has the in-app learning for home learning on a tablet or mobile. And also it has optional workbooks, student books, and support materials for offline learning as well. So if you're interested in exploring further, modern edtech, like Studycat for Schools, leaves us teachers free to focus on collaboration and communication in the classroom, which is what we do best as teachers. Now, if you'd like to experience Studycat for Schools, you can sign up now for your free trial account at Studycat for Schools with access to over 500 award-winning games, activities to engage young learners, both online and offline classes. And most importantly, you can be assured that pedagogically, the app ticks all the boxes for the scientific principles of learning. It's a natural extension for the way we learn. Ever since 200 years ago, from Friedrich Froebel starting to focus on learning through play, all the way the evolution of learning through play to today, where play is synonymous with learning on an app. So all you have to do, if you'd like to know more, is go to studycat.com/schools and sign up. I hope that I'll be able to see you there. And I'm a few minutes early, I believe, but that's fine. Hopefully there'll be some questions there that I can answer. Which would be great. So let's see, questions from Samir. If there isn't any access to internet, which plays would you recommend using? Well, the great thing is you can play offline, which is wonderful. So as long as you can get access at some point to download the app, you should be fine. And then when you can connect, you'll be able to, all the data will be uploaded to the dashboards and you can see what your students have done and what they're struggling with, what they can be challenged on further in class. Let's see, Katrina King. Oh, hello, Katrina. Says, did you notice higher engagement from parents as well as learners when you introduced this app to classes? Absolutely. Of course, I'm biased, but you can immediately see parents take much more of an interest in their students' progress when they can see specifically what the children have been able to do and even better, not able to do. And you find that parents are kind of much more willing to engage with you as a teacher. Especially in Asia, where you get a lot of, as they call, tiger mums and tiger dads, who are very curious to know exactly what the students learn every class. This is a great way for them to feel engaged in their students' learning journey. So yes, we found that both from learners and parents, it's been a huge help. Let's see, question from Julie. Is this only for schools? Can freelance teachers use this? Absolutely, it's extremely flexible. Freelance teachers can log in and just use however many student accounts you need. The great thing is at the beginning of the year, when the pandemic struck, we were helping an awful lot of teachers, both schools and online teachers, use online teaching. And they were teaching from their laptops, showing it on the screen. And the great thing was there was a smooth progression from finishing the class and seeing the study cat on his adventures on the screen to then playing the app on their phone or tablet in their spare time. Somebody asks, Anonymous, are you planning to upgrade for upper primary grades too? Absolutely, yes. At the moment, we're just aligned with Cambridge Starters, but we are planning to move into movers and flyers as well as 2021 goes through. From Carmel, we have Studycat from level 1 to 3 and kindergarten. So yes, really it's the level at the moment is starts from pre-A1 when a learner first meets the language all the way through. From ages, it'll be roughly from 3 to 8, but different countries start learning English at different times. So it's always better to go with the CEFR, I find. But yes, from pre-A1 through to A1, and slowly we'll be building that out to higher levels as well. Ank says, thank you for interesting talk. Please repeat the scientific reference. I'm sure we'll be able to see this at the end. I'll make sure the slides are available with a reference slide at the end. Let's see. Katya says, would you recommend any particular app, teacher time ration, or does it depend on the class student? Katya, it really depends on the class student, but many teachers have found great success just with 5 minutes at home to consolidate that learning in class. Or if the school is doing flipped learning, by doing it 5 minutes before they go to class, so they can turn up at the school already knowing the vocabulary and getting ready to use that in a collaborative, cooperative way in the class. Let's see, can we do immersion to acquire language for adults? Absolutely, immersion works for everybody, but StudyCat for Schools is just aimed at young learners at the moment. Oh, Katya, ratio, ration. Yes, absolutely. Some parents do worry about the amount of screen time that young learners have, especially when they're a little bit younger. But as I've mentioned, even if it's 5 minutes, it's absolutely fine. It will still help to consolidate and prepare the learner for the next class, which is amazing. Another anonymous question. What is the age or the target group? Usually we say it's between 3 and 8 years old. But again, it really depends on the student's age range. Sorry. Ability level, so normally would look at the CEFR level. Let's see, from Tanzila. Nice session, thanks again, you're welcome. Is it learning-centered or student-centered? We would love to think it's both. the student gets really, with the app, is a one-to-one connection. So the algorithm ensures that the learning is personalized, so it's student-centered because they see the things they struggle with more often. But also it's learning centered as well because it's focused on the outcomes. Great. Oh, sorry for speaking very fast there with the Q&As, but I was very aware I was running out of time. So I think that's everything. If there's any other questions, please type them in the Q&A box now and I'd be more than happy to answer them. But I think these slides will be, obviously the video will be available to watch on YouTube at a later date on the YLTSIG YouTube channel. I'll make sure that these slides are available. And if you do go to studycat.com/schools to sign up, it'll be myself or one of my colleagues that gets back to you to open the demo account for you. So you can try with one of your classes of learners. Often we find that there's a little bit of resistance for teachers to try new things, but we've made it as simple as possible for you to get started. And often just starting with one class as an experimental class is a great way to start, to dip your toe into using app learning as well. Oh, another question from Margaret. Can teachers design their own tasks or assign them to students? Absolutely, not within the app. You can assign homework from the app automatically. So when you would log into your teacher dashboard, you simply select which activities you'd like your students to do, click assign these as homework, and then when the student logs in at home, the homework would pop up and then click that button to get started. For other activities outside the app, that's where you know, you'd carry on and do your normal classroom or your normal lesson in class to do expansion or alternative options and extension activities. Another question, Katrina, did you notice engagement levels went up even in parents who don't speak English? Actually, yes. You know, the great thing is when you have students who are kind of naturally intrinsically motivated, you end up, and it's great to encourage the young learners to actually teach their parents as well, because you've probably heard that old adage, you know, to really understand and to learn, teach. And by putting your young learners as teachers of their parents, you know, they can scold their parents, go, no, mommy, your pronunciation, say it again. And then you find that parents can learn a smattering of the words that their young learners are learning as well. And again, that really increases that connection between parents, students, and teachers, which at StudyCat, we're passionate believers in connecting these three groups of people to enhance learner outcomes. Okay. I think that's everybody, and I think my time's done.
Thank you so much, Dave, for such an interesting talk and really helping unpack 100 years of play and play-based approach and play-based principles and how that links to the apps that StudyCat have been developing. So it was a really fascinating whirlwind tour. We have more coming up from StudyCat with the blog post. StudyCat, Jake Whitten from StudyCat is our monthly guest blogger for the month of December, and his blog post will be going live. Letitia will type the link to our blog. It's freely accessible, open access on the YLTSIG website. So please check out Jake's blog as he also expands on a play-based approach and links it to learning technologies, particularly apps. So huge thanks again to Dave and all the StudyCat team.